It has been a pretty easy start to the new year for me. I've been on a bit of a recovery week, so I've just been rotating sort of rest days and easy rides. Tomorrow I get back down to some hard work, which means today I'm on a 3-hour ride, riding a little bit harder just to wake the legs up before tomorrow's torture session. I'm on my normal 3-hour loop, and there's this amazing road as you hit the small town called El Poquico or something like that. And it's really small, but it's brand new, and it kind of cuts straight back across direction home for me. And it's basically like a racetrack. It's brand new, it's not super wide, and it is crazy twisty. It's just an amazing road. There's also a river crossing in the middle where they've just decided not to deal with it and just make you go through the river. With a tailwind, you can just absolutely rip it. I'll try and show a bit of it, but again, cell phone camera and riding at high speeds through corners is pretty sketchy. But I'll give it a go. Ends and you have this. Tar just turns to straight up just dry riverbed, and with the rains we had a couple weeks ago, this turned into like legit a river. Like I had to legit ride through a river to get back to an immaculate tar road again on the other side. What you done? It's so simple. They seem to grow a fair amount of stuff around here, obviously because the climate's pretty good. Seen some broccoli, lemons, oranges, fair amount of stuff. My vlog setup is like super ghetto. I'm filming out on the road with my phone, and then I'm using this SLR. I don't have lights, I don't have a tripod, I just have to like put the camera on things, but I mean this is working pretty well with the sea in the background. I've had a few questions down in the comments about power meters. Usually I just answer them down there, but someone asked me to make a video about power meters and basically like my experience with them, which ones I've used, etc, etc. So I thought I'd have a crack at it. There's a lot of information on YouTube, on Google, on There's a ton of information, so if what I'm giving you is not good enough, just hit a good Google search and do some reading. It will pay off. There's a lot of good resources out there. The first and most important thing I get from a power meter is to track fatigue. Every ride produces a stress score, and that is then plotted into Golden Cheetah or Training Peaks, whatever it is. That gives you your long run or chronic training load. You also have your acute training load or a shorter training load, and then it also gives you a training stress balance or like a fatigue kind of measure. That is how we make all decisions around training, whether I'm good to do a big session or if I need easier days. It is all based around what is called the PMC, the performance management chart. Decisions are made with that chart, and I wouldn't be able to train the way I do without having those numbers, that ATL, that CTL, and that TSB. Secondly, it allows me to directly compare sessions to each other. So there are a few sessions that I do fairly often during the season that I'll use in the build-ups to certain races and, you know, certain VO2 max kind of sessions or threshold sessions or whatever they are, and it allows me to go and directly compare what I was doing a few weeks ago to what I'm doing now, or a few months ago to what I'm doing now, or even last year to what I'm doing now, because it's giving me a specific number. Whereas with heart rate, you might get the exact same heart rate from a session, but your wattage could be wildly different depending on your fitness or your fatigue levels or whatever it is. So being able to directly compare and see your progress is massively motivating to me. And it's also really important because it lets you know, hey, what I'm doing is working and I must keep pushing on with it. Or it could also say, look, you've stagnated. There's no point in continuing to do what you're doing. You need to change it up and do something different to provide different stress to move forward. The third thing for me is pacing. Knowing exactly how much power you can produce over certain periods of time allows you to pace your efforts really well. Whether that be in a time trial, knowing, hey, this is gonna take me 20 minutes, this is what I can produce for 20 minutes normally, so therefore I'm gonna start at this wattage and go from there. Or even if it's just an interval set, you can go back and be like, okay, well, last time I did this, I did the first one at 400, the next one at 380, and the last one at 360, then I know, okay, you know, that's kind of the ballpark I'm going to be in. And obviously I'm going to push as hard as possible, but it saves me going out at 450 for the first 5 minutes and then just dying completely in the second 5 minutes. It allows me to do a steadier 400 watt effort. So those are the sort of three biggest factors for me, but they could well be different to you. What value you get from a power meter depends on your goals and what you're doing. I got my first power meter at the end of 2007 for my birthday. It was a PowerTap, whatever it was. It was the first sort of wireless edition that they made. I actually made a full video about it, which I'll link just up here. And that was from 2007. The hub is still working, which is freaking impressive. It's like it's coming up, it'll be 10 years at the end of this year. From there, in 2012, I got myself a Quark. At the time it was a Cinco, and that has since been upgraded to a Riken just through warranties. And I also have a Stages power meter, mainly just because SRAM compatibility is quite difficult sometimes. I use the Stages when I'm in a pinch and need to put it on a Shimano bike, because having to change the bottom bracket to be compatible with like SRAM GXP is a bit of a pain sometimes. When I first started out, the PowerTap was perfect for me. Firstly, the SRM was like crazy expensive, and the PowerTap was pretty much the only other thing on the market. And my needs at the time, it was perfect. I was training on it during the week and then just slapping on my race wheels and racing on the weekend. The hub was like bomb proof. It's still going 9 years later. The batteries were easy to change, and it was very easy to change between bikes. If I, you know, if I'd had a time trial bike and wanted to do a session on that, I can just flip it on that or whatever it was. The only negative was that it was quite heavy back then, and you were kind of stuck with one wheel, so that when I wanted to race, I would have to put on a race wheel, which now would be a bit of an issue because I wouldn't be getting the data from those races. At the end of 2012, I wanted to get onto a crank-based power meter so that I could start monitoring all my fatigue and really get all that race data together and use it to train better. And at the time, there was pretty much only two choices other than the SRM. There was the Quark and the Power 2 Max. The Power 2 Max had just been released and wasn't quite what it is now, so I went with the Quark. I got the Quark Cinco. It was reasonably priced and it worked really well. In the 4 years that I've had the Quark, I've had pretty much two issues, mainly due to water. I've had the Quark Cinco warrantied, which was then bumped up to a Riken, and I had that first Riken warrantied as well, also due to water damage, just in the pouring rain in a race, and it just didn't start the next day. It's a power meter that I would go back to over and over again. It's reasonably priced, the data's really good, and in general it's pretty reliable. The next power meter that I've used is the Stages, and the best thing about the Stages is the price. It's extremely affordable for a crank-based system. It's super easy to install. You just pull off the left arm and put the new one on, and the data is pretty solid. It's been really reliable. I've got one and Sarah's got one. The only thing I'm not a huge fan of the Stages with is there's a bit of a data delay. With the Quark, when you like stand up or accelerate or whatever it is, you see the number on the screen like really quickly. There's very little delay between the change in power and actually getting it onto your screen. I find there's more like maybe a 1 or 2 second delay with the Stages, where I'll start pedaling and I'll still get a zero for another maybe second or two, and then the power will actually kick in. And from there, it's really accurate. It's just that it's a bit behind. It doesn't react as fast as the Quark does, which in the grand scheme of things is extremely unimportant. I mean, we're talking a 1 or 2 second delay here, but in general, that's such a small thing. You also now have a lot of pedal-based power meters. You have the Garmin Vectors, and you have the PowerTap, I think the P1 pedals or whatever. I have no experience with those, but I have heard good things about the PowerTap P1. I've got a friend who uses them, and I think if you're someone who travels a lot and is using different bikes, or if you have a lot of different bikes, then pedals are amazing for changing between bikes really quickly. Wow, it got dark. Sun's just gone behind the mountain. Get rid of those. So really, the power meter you need completely depends on your needs and depends on your finances. If I had an unlimited amount of money to spend on a power meter, I probably would buy an SRM. They're reliable, the data's good. I mean, there's a reason it is the gold standard in power meters. But, you know, take that down to trying to spend less than $1,000, and Power 2 Max is definitely in there, Quark is in there, set of the P1 pedals is not far off. there's a lot of options. If you want to spend even less than that, you've got the Stages, which is really reasonable, and you've got a Canadian company called 4III or 4II or something. They are making really good power meters, and they supply the Quickstep team this year. One of the things that is overlooked, but I think is probably the most important, is customer service. Using a power meter brand that has good customer service is super important. After all, they're electronic devices that are used for extended periods of time, for hundreds of hours. They're used in all conditions, and there is always a possibility that something's gonna happen. My PowerTap, no problems. My Quark has had two issues, and Quark has been amazing with the customer service. I literally took the Spider in, and I bought it in South Africa, and I wanted to change it in France. I took the Spider in, I took my receipt in, and I had a new one in 2 or 3 days. And to me, that is incredibly valuable. There's always a chance that it's gonna break or not work so well or whatever it is. If you Google Stages problems, you're gonna find some. If you Google Quark issues, you're gonna find some. If you Google SRM issues, you're gonna find some. It's just almost the luck of the draw in that sense. So having a company that says, send it back in and we'll send you a new one ASAP is really important, because there is always that chance that it will go wrong. Beyond just sort of minor negatives for each of the three power meters that I've owned, I really don't have any major complaints. I think they've all been really solid, and I would happily recommend them to pretty much any rider who's looking for that specific power meter. But the biggest recommendation I can give to anyone is check out the customer service. Rather Google Quark customer service than Quark problems, because I'd rather know that I can get a new power meter quickly, I can get something warranted, or I can have a problem sorted fast, than have a power meter that is less likely to break.